So we're going to do about 20 minutes of still focusing on the panel three papers, allow Professor Legomsky and Professor Baum to respond to some of Mr. Wheeler's comments, and then we're going to open it up to general discussion about their paper specifically, and then just about the conference generally, if you have any questions that you wrote down that you didn't get a chance to ask, or just kind of reflections on the day. So Mr. Press Legomsky.
Okay, thanks, Natalie. First of all, great comments from both Larry and Russell. They've both embarrassingly identified a number of flaws in my proposal. So I would have preferred feedback that just said, everything is perfect, just leave it as is. But this was very helpful to me. A couple responses to qualify what I just said about how much I like the comments. Now I want to say what I disagree with. Larry makes the point, which I do agree with, that the benefits of specialization will be reduced if, as is highly possible, Congress fails to adequately resource the new court that I'm proposing. In fact, it would be fair to say with inadequate resources, all the benefits of adjudication are probably reduced. But the one place where I look at it a little bit differently is that I do think that even if resources are unfortunately reduced, specialization still has benefits. And one of them is that all else equal, a specialist can decide a case typically more quickly with the same level of competence, because the specialist doesn't have to take time to familiarize himself with or herself with the general background. So there might be some cost efficiency there. Also, specialists, especially if there are fewer of them, can make their decisions a little bit more inconsistent, a little more consistent among each other. I think there are lots of other benefits of specialization that still would apply even in a world in which resources are lower than they ought to be. I won't go through them. That book that Phil mentioned that I had written back in 1990, Specialized Justice, lays out what I see as all the benefits and costs of specialized adjudication, and then it goes on to identify the different attributes that cases might have that would either increase or decrease the weight that one should place on those various benefits and costs, and it goes on to outline different forms of specialization, multiple specialty forums, et cetera. So I'd refer anybody to that if you want to see which of the advantages of specialization would still persist even if resources were too low. Another excellent point by both Larry and Russell about appointment politics. On the selection of judges, I agree. I don't like the idea of one individual naming people, whether that individual is the president or the chief justice. In addition to Ravesh, a former colleague of mine, Ted Ruger, has done some excellent writing on how dangerous it is when you let one individual, even the chief justice of the U.S., name a bunch of people to one court, especially if the court the person is naming the people to is a specialized court, because now you're almost flouting the principle of random selection of judicial panels in a different way. You're naming people with particular points of view on particular subjects to decide that group of cases, which I think is dangerous. That's why I propose to put the selection in the hands of a significantly larger group of people rather than any one individual. It doesn't eliminate the problem entirely, but at least it mitigates it somewhat. Great comments as well from Russell. The funding point that he makes is very well taken. I have to admit, I don't think I had thought that through as carefully as I should have. There is a risk that Congress could be stingier with the resources than even DOJ has been. I acknowledge that risk. I detect some skepticism.
I think he thought you said DOJ, I heard After the
dinner last night, I would never make that comment about DLJ. That also makes me feel guilty, because when Natalie first invited me to be part of this, I was delighted. But I didn't know, and she hadn't banked on the fact that they'd have to be flying me in, you'd have to be flying me in from Portugal. So I've turned out to be a much more expensive date than you thought I was going to be. I'm sorry for that. Okay, now that we've gotten past the laughter and the mocking. No, I appreciate that, David. Thank you. But at my age, it takes another 10 minutes for me to get back on track, so bear with me. Here's what I was going to say. Yes, that's a risk. Congress could be stingier. But as I think about it now, I'm not sure I could think of any systematic institutional reason to predict that an executive branch department is going to be any more likely to place a high priority on funding adjudication than the legislative department of our government would be, even if it is within DOJ, even if it's within the same department. The reason I say that is that it seems to me that the priority you're going to place on adjudication depends so heavily on your own general ideological views, and that means that the priority is going to depend on the composition of both the particular Congress and the particular administration. Right now, DOJ has been really fussy, and I can recall, in fact, one of the panels before the House Immigration Subcommittee where I testified, one of the other witnesses was, I can't believe I'm blanking on his name, Kevin Olson, the chair of, the current director of EOIR. The committee absolutely abused Kevin Olson for failing. They were really abusing him as a way of abusing his superiors, I think, but for failing to request additional resources for EOIR. And several members of that panel said, we want to give you more money. Why on earth aren't you requesting it? So that's an example of where at least one subcommittee, I don't want to generalize this to the whole Congress, might have been more sympathetic than the particular Justice Department in the particular administration. I do admit, however, that it could work the other way around as well, and therefore I have to acknowledge that that's a risk. And finally, excellent point by Russell. There's no way Congress is going to give Barack Obama or any other president the authority to name 40 new judges, and if they did, I think all of us can imagine the food fights that would emerge at the confirmation hearings with every single judge. I don't discount that risk. Russell, however, made an extremely important counterpoint in his article, which is something I hadn't known, actually, and that is that in 2007, apparently, correct me if I have this wrong, Russell, there was some bipartisan support for an Omnibus Judge Act because the particular bill contained a provision which said that the addition of the new judges would not occur until the new administration took office. And this was done at a time when no one could confidently predict which party was going to win the election. Now, there was a lot of risk aversion, and apparently that's why even that didn't pass. But maybe a condition like that would at least raise this from the category of no way to the category of still unlikely, but there's a chance, maybe. And even though I said that was the last point, I didn't really mean it. I actually have one more point, and that is that, to be candid, despite everything I've just said, I would not bet on my proposal passing either. In order for that to happen, three things would have to happen. First of all, there's no way any of these proposals would pass unless they are incorporated into a comprehensive immigration reform bill, and comprehensive immigration reform is itself very iffy at this point. Second, even if the committee is otherwise, if Congress is otherwise willing to pass a CIR bill, none of this would matter unless they include a radical restructuring of the immigration adjudication system, which has another level of improbability. And third, for my proposal to pass, it would mean they'd have to prefer mine to the other reform proposals, which again is probably improbable. So when you level, when you put together those three levels of improbability, and now I'm drawing on my actuarial background, the probability becomes smaller still. Nonetheless, I don't think it's impossible. I wouldn't waste my time on something that I think really had no chance at all. The fact that the subcommittee affirmatively contacted me, I had no idea they were interested, and asked me to do the considerable amount of work it takes to draft a bill, not that they care if I waste all my time working on it, but the fact that they would go out of their way to ask suggested to me that at least the staff council thought that there was some chance. And after submitting the bill, I asked again, have I just wasted my time, or is there a chance of CIR? Is there a chance that adjudication restructuring could be part of it? Is there a chance that if it is, this proposal could be that restructuring? And he said, yes, yes, and yes. He said, but we're not guaranteeing it. We're not forecasting the probabilities. But there's enough of a chance that we really do think it's worthwhile, and we intend to push for some type of immigration adjudication reform. It might not be mine. Probably won't be mine, but there might be a chance.
I don't feel fully qualified or even partly qualified to assess Steve's proposal because too much of it depends on the kind of expertise that he has in the immigration system that I don't. But I wanted to use the proposal as kind of a taking off point to talk about a couple of issues. The first is what it means for a person's behavior to be a specialist. You know, in most of the world, we assume specialization's good. I mean, after all, most of the world is specialized. The idea of a generalist lawyer would now strike everybody as rather strange because of the belief that specialization is necessary to gain the kind of expertise that helps a lawyer to do the job well. On the other hand, when we talk about judges, at least federal judges, we tend to assume that there are things about the idea of being a generalist that are good. Well, both those ideas are quite reasonable, and yet we don't really know too much about what they mean in practice. And I was talking to Steve during the break about the question of what difference it would make if a Second Circuit judge who already hears 40% of their cases in immigration were to become a full-time for 2 years immigration judge. Steve argued very plausibly that there would be some additional benefits and expertise, and he may well be right about that. That, though, is not at all certain, nor is it certain how it would affect their mindset. If somebody is doing nothing other than deciding immigration cases for 2 years, they might become immersed in that field, which would have good or bad effects. They might feel a responsibility for the field, which could have good or bad effects of several types. And that's pretty important. And to go back to the theme that you're tired of already, it's one of those things that we should know more about than we do if we're going to assess this kind of proposal. The other thing I want to talk about, I've already talked about appointment politics, and I want to talk about them in the context of his specific proposal, where the circuit council would decide which judges would be deputized to go to the immigration court, and as I understand it, a judge would be able to say, no, no, not me. I will not go. Well, that's two interesting things. First, one could imagine the majority in the circuit deciding to get rid of somebody for 2 years by putting on this court. Let me go home to the Sixth Circuit. Some of you might know the Sixth Circuit is closely divided between two competing sides that hate each other. Suppose one side had a majority. Well, let's get rid of a couple of those folks. I have no idea whether that would occur. It's a possibility. And there might be other kinds of politics going on within the circuit. Now, what about a judge's ability to veto his or her own assignment? What that would mean is the judges who found this attractive would be, or not too unattractive, would be the ones who go. Now, I'm not sure what that would mean, whether that would create any biases. And if it did, what kinds of biases it would create. Judge Posner made an interesting point about the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, where judges are appointed by the Chief Justice, but basically they have to be willing. And what Posner pointed out is a judge who is willing to go to that court, one prerequisite for which is to undergo a security clearance, might not be the random judge in terms of their attitudes toward issuing warrants for intelligence surveillance. Quite aside from any bias on the part of the Chief Justice. Now, this is not an argument for or against this feature of the proposal, but it's a reminder that both on the supply side and on the demand side, whatever system is used to select judges could introduce some interesting kinds of processes and potentially some biases into the composition of such a court.
I don't really have an awful lot to add. I do want to say this, that although I'm very dubious that this or any other major restructuring proposal will pass, certainly any major restructuring proposal that I suspect most of the people in this room would look favorably upon, I don't mean to suggest at all that it's not worth considering. Lightning may strike, and the discussions we're having now are built on some 20 or 30 years of analysis, rejection, and improvement of other proposals. So I'd be the last one to say that this isn't a worthwhile exercise. And as to the appointment process, I would look less towards the dynamics that Larry describes, although they're possible. I just think it would be a logistical nightmare, as I pointed out before. Congress is not going to give up the patronage of assigning judges, these new judges, to the districts. They're not going to give that up to the circuit councils. So you almost, it would seem to me inevitable, you'd get certain districts, which are inevitably the donor districts, to the new court, because they're the ones who have the increased judge to make up for the change, unless you envision Congress authorizing a squadron. You know, some judges that just rotate around the circuit. I mean, I don't mean to nitpick all of this, but the devil is often in the details, and I think the details of this proposal would become quite burdensome quite quickly. Finally, as to why we assume the Justice Department might be a better protector than Congress, of the interest of the immigration adjudication system. I grant you that those questions that Steve said, they get asked at every appropriations hearings. There's nothing to stop an appropriations subcommittee from upping the amount of money that an agency requests and directing them to spend it in a certain way. And that's what they have not done. I can see some representatives. I mean, these appropriations hearings serve one purpose, and that is to get headlines in the paper back home. And I can understand why they would say that. But I think, I still think this Darwinian process of getting through the OMB review process, and then in the appropriations process, you're basically just competing with the other agencies that the leadership has dumped into the appropriations subcommittees. And I think I'd rather have some crusty attorney general up there saying, boy, you know, I'm really concerned about immigration. We got to improve this court system. If that had ever happened, I'd think of that a lot better than an immigration judge, tell you the truth. I just think the chances would be better that way. But obviously, all this business is quite iffy. I ended my paper with this quote from Reinhold Niebuhr that people trot out all the time, and I apologize for it. But boy, it's sure applicable here. Democracy is a method of finding proximate solutions to insoluble problems, and that's what this one is. On that happy, optimistic note, I'll stop.
Areas. One of the problems that I don't see getting solved is what we have with the AWOs, which I didn't know about because I haven't read your article, and that really scared me. And I'm afraid that in a more efficient, streamlined, smaller staffed, specialized court, there will be even more pressure to rubber stamp decisions on the way up. And I'm wondering how we could account for that and make sure that every case is getting the proper level of review.
That's a very interesting question. And you know the environmental field much better than I do. To me, the thing that would stand out is, technical though the field is, there are very strong ideological interests on both sides. And I would think that the creation of such a court would at least create the potential for politicization in the kind of colloquial sense of the word, because is a high priority for people in both the left and the right. And this might be an area in which appointments would be made in an effort to influence the direction the court took. That in no way is to downgrade the concern you have, but I don't think that would be so much of a concern, because people would be taking the cases seriously, and because you don't have this enormous kind of volume, where just as in the criminal field, the primary goal often becomes just get the cases out as opposed to how you decide them. But again, you can assess this better than I can, I think, because of your knowledge of the field.
I think I would add maybe two things. One is, it seems to me there are at least two different kinds of technicality when we talk about some areas being more technical than others. Pardon me. Some areas are technical just because the law is legally very intricate. The statute is just extremely complicated, as it is in immigration or in tax, for example, or in the case of NEPA or some of the other environmental legislation. But another part of technical complexity to me is, does it involve non-law, for example, scientific sorts of judgments, as environmental law would? The more of the latter it requires, it seems to me, the more beneficial it is to have non-legal experts involved in the process in some way. The other thing I was going to say is that it sounded to me as if the main concern in your question is, if this is a smaller court, is that going to mean more cases per judge and therefore less time per case? And I don't know that follows. I think in the end, that concern is going to boil down to some of the points that Russell was making. What's Congress willing to provide in the way of resources? Will we have as much in the way of resources per case, or will we have more, will we have less, will it be the same? So I think it really does come down to that.
One of the things that I thought was very interesting about your paper, Larry, that didn't come out so much during the discussion was the way you described immigration cases as difficult cases, meaning the fact-finding is difficult, knowing country conditions is difficult, and there are credibility determinations involved, and moral judgments. And my understanding, and your presentation changes a little bit, of the reason for creating specialized courts was when you needed technical expertise, like in the environmental context, as you just said, when things like science are involved. And the INA is complex and Byzantine, but one can figure it out without getting a PhD in the INA. You know, I mean, unlike some of these environmental questions that would require technical expertise. And so I wondered if what was really the problem was not so much the lack of specialization, but something distinct. And then this obviously is not a real proposal, but the way that you described it made me think that actually what needs to be done here is these cases need to be sent to juries. I mean, these are the kinds of difficult questions, credibility, judging facts, applying law to facts, and sympathy and morality that in the criminal system the jury is there for. Of course, a lot of that process has gotten shoveled into the plea bargaining process, into an administrative process, and that is itself a problem in the criminal context. That's really just an observation about the dynamics that it made me think about in your paper. But Steve, the question for you is, I sort of thought of what you were trying to do as similar to what I was trying to get at, in that I'm looking for the optimal point of insulation versus accountability, and you're looking for the optimal point of specialization versus generalism. Because you want to, at least in the paper, you want to maintain something of the generalist form of review. But during the presentation, the discussion, that's really dropped out, it seems like. And it's really more the focus on having a specialized immigration court. So I'm wondering if the balance that you're drawing is really in the favor of specialization, or if there's still some value to the generalist judge. And some of that, I think, is the percolation around the system when you have an interpretation of a statute that might be involved that you eventually want, maybe it's to resolve, but you need the work done by the lower courts. Also, these morality questions, better to have a kind of generalist approach to them as opposed to a common sense approach as opposed to a specialized approach. And so I worried on the one hand about your proposal and that creating the specialized court could, for many of the reasons that Larry has described, lead to an internalist dynamic that loses a lot of what I thought you were trying to balance in the system by keeping Article 3 involved. But then I thought that maybe a good analogy for you would be the D.C. Circuit, where they are Article III generalist judges, but they are administrative law judges. And yet, I mean, I don't know, there might be studies on whether or not they've become overly specialized. They tend to favor the government. I don't think they do. I think the party of the president who appointed the judges says more about that than the fact that they are a specialized court. But the other thing that's present in the D.C. Circuit model that's not necessarily in yours is that a lot of these cases, there are some opportunities for other courts of appeals to weigh in. So you do sometimes get circuit splits about interpretations of statutes. A lot of statutes allow you to appeal either to the D.C. Circuit or to one of the courts of appeals where the dispute arose. And so there's some of the generalist backstops that might not exist in your proposal. So really a roundabout way of asking how important that generalism is and if there are ways other than just having people rotate off every 2 years to
serve
that
value. Yeah, that's a great question. I'll take the last part first because that's the easiest. I can't think of any other ways. that was why I proposed this. But on the main part of your question, I didn't intend to emphasize specialization over the generalist perspective, either in the paper or in the presentation. So if it came across that way, that wasn't what I was thinking or what meaning to say. I think, as it turns out, there's a little. Discussing specialization maybe takes a little more space than discussing the generalist perspective. But no, I think the generalist perspective is extremely important. And that's why I was unhappy with the proposals made 30 years ago, I guess, by Maury Roberts, whom I adore and revere, and Peter Levinson, whom I also have a very high opinion of, because they would have simply replaced EOIR with an immigration court with two divisions and then abolished Court of Appeals review. And I didn't like that idea specifically because you lose the generalist perspective. But as I think about it now, when I think of what it is about the generalist perspective that I find so important, it seems to me that all of the things I can think of would be preserved under my proposal. One reason you want the generalist perspective, for example, is that generalist judges can draw on analogies from other areas of law, especially administrative law, but other areas as well. These judges with 3 years of experience should hopefully be able to do that. Another reason, I think, is that generalists are less likely, I don't want to exaggerate this difference, than specialists to come to the position with really fixed, dogmatic, preconceived views on the issues. That's not to say they won't form soon enough once they become specialists, but at least they'll arrive with fewer preconceptions than the experts probably do. I mean, all of us who have worked in immigration for a few years would be hard-pressed to say, oh, no, my mind is open on all of these issues. I've never formed opinions on any of them. We all have. A third reason that I like generalists so much is one of the things I discuss in the paper to some extent, and Larry talks about this as well, and that's their relatively lesser susceptibility to lobbyists. And I think my proposal preserves that because it's not as if lobbyists would have an incentive to oppose the appointment of generalist judges any more than they do now, simply on because it's possible that 3 years from now that judge could spend 2 years on the Court of Appeals any more than they would have an incentive to oppose a judge just because under the present system the judge would have a certain number of immigration cases. So I can't really think of any real benefits of the generalist perspective that would be lost. The one qualification I would add is the atmosphere, the environment, just the ambiance might be slightly different. When you're immersed in this stuff day after day, I think there is some danger, especially in asylum cases, for example, that you start discounting the severities of what happens to people. I would worry, if I were an asylum adjudicator, do things that horrify me now, would they still horrify me if day after day I hear these compelling tales of human tragedy, or rather would I start to discount these? Well, yeah, what happened to this poor woman was a shame, but boy, it's nothing compared to what happened to some of these other cases I've dealt with. So I think that would be the major concern I would have.
This matter of case difficulty, I'm glad you raised that, because it's a very interesting one. And what you're saying is that cases can be difficult for a lot of different reasons.
Well, you're, I think you're saying that with
people. Yeah. So, immigration, I think those cases are difficult because of the factual ambiguity. But the areas of federal jurisdiction that people usually talk about as being difficult are taxes and patents. And those are difficult in two different ways. With patents, it's the technicality of the facts. The law is pretty simple. With patents, with taxes, the facts tend not to be that complicated, but the law is very complicated. But to go back to the environmental example, which I think ties in with this, just because an area is technical doesn't mean that it's all technical, that there's no politics to it. So when the Federal Circuit was created in 1982 and patent cases were moved from the Courts of Appeals to the Federal Circuit, it was depicted by everybody as simply getting cases to experts who knew better. And then people were saying under their breath so they would not be heard, and the patent experts favor one side and we want that side to do better, which of course they did when the court was created. So that, well, first of all, I think you're absolutely right about the facts, and we have to think about, I'm sorry, about the difficulty. We have to think about what it is that makes cases difficult, because it's not always the same. But second, technical difficulty doesn't necessarily mean that everything is simply technical. And again, I would go back to the environmental field, where I think that would be true as well. And one of the dilemmas then is if expertise is needed. Let's say that a regular Court of Appeals judge or a district judge can't figure out the technicalities of a lot of patents. How do you provide that expertise without bringing a bias with it? And that, I think, is very difficult.
Yeah. Let me state these are short questions to state. Once you find the factors that prompt choosing immigration law for specialized court, what specialized court, not now in existence, comes in second place? That's a thought experiment question. I think it's important. Second, during the experiments.opinion period, we had essentially passed through the Court of Appeals. And so isn't this proposal ultimately an end run around judicial review laws? I wanted to see that. Third question, what's the link to Jennifer's treatment of the relationship between criminal and immigration? Because this would result in criminal cases being not in a specialized court, the non-criminal immigration cases being in a specialized court, a phenomenon that would expand if her analysis of the implementation of immigration proves to be true, which I think is
great question, Hiroshi, as always. The first one I don't feel qualified to comment on. I just don't know enough about any of the other subjects.
I raise a thought experiment because I think that is what the bigger picture funder would ask. Go ahead.
Sure. I mean, my reasons for functioning on, for focusing on immigration are, first, that's what I do for a living. But second, the immigration system is so clearly dysfunctional, and I think there's a consensus that it's dysfunctional. So this one is in need of repair. But you raise a fair question. If once we do this with immigration, are we setting a precedent that establishes a similar case for other areas? So I have to think about what other areas might qualify. Is it an end run around judicial review bars? Absolutely. I say that it's not a sneaky end run, because I say that on the paper. One of the great benefits, I think, of this is that it would effectively abolish the 1996 restrictions on judicial review and enable Article III review of issues that right now are subject to no appellate review at all by an independent decision maker. Criminal cases in specialized courts, that's an interesting question. You're right that a lot of criminal cases are immigration violations. In fact, it got to the point, I wish I could remember the exact number, as of about a year ago, I believe, according to the information compiled by TRAC at the University of Syracuse, I believe it got to the point where approximately one-half, this will shock people, about one-half of all federal criminal prosecutions in the United States were immigration cases.
And that's misdemeanor and felony both.
Right, misdemeanor and felony. The vast majority were, in fact, misdemeanors, but they are still criminal cases. My view is that those cases, while they can present complexities like any other court cases, are much easier cases. They do raise occasional legal issues, but most of them are, you entered without inspection, usually not a whole lot of doubt there, or you entered by fraud, or you had fraudulent documentation, you assisted others to cross into the U.S. illegally. So I think those cases probably don't present the technical complexities and therefore as much need for specialized expertise as the removal cases did. But I must confess I haven't thought about it, and I probably need to think about it more.
Let me just address the first question in one sense. Leaving aside how desirable specialization is, if you look at the current array of federal courts, which areas of jurisdiction are under specialized court, which aren't, it doesn't make any sense. Because it's a result of very specific decisions made when there was a specific felt need at a particular time. There's no grand design. Well, take taxes and patents. If the problem with taxes is that the law is complicated, and the problem with patents is that the facts are complicated, then you should have a specialized trial court for patents and a special appellate court for taxes. We've got just the opposite. And so we have a very strange kind of system simply because there's never been a general design. Even if there had been, maybe it wouldn't have been the right one. But it's simply the result of very idiosyncratic decisions that have been made at particular times because somebody felt there was a need to act.
And the reason the Federal Circuit doesn't have tax jurisdiction as well as patent is that the tax bar fought it vigorously when the court was created and the patent bar didn't.
This discussion brings something to mind for me. It's very difficult to listen, knowing how badly the system needs reform, and then keep hearing, but it's not going to happen. You know it's not going to happen. Oh, it's not going to happen. I have a question out of history of specialized courts, courts that have sprung up either to take something off the initial jurisdiction of the Article III courts, or as a result of the generation of something in the executive adjudications area that needed to be more formally adjudicated. Do any of you from this history know of a specialized court now in existence that came into existence in a way that you could imagine immigration giving birth to something perhaps similar?
Well, the Court of International Trade might be an example, which is grew out of administrative agencies, but that's 12 judges. That's a much smaller thing than what we're talking about here. I can't think of anything else.
I don't think there is a parallel. Yeah.
There might be someone here. There's undoubtedly someone here who knows more about the bankruptcy courts.
The bankruptcy court basically arose out of the fact that district judges didn't want to deal with bankruptcy cases. When the federal bankruptcy system was created in the 1890s, jurisdiction was given to the district judges. they were also given, what were they called then, trustees?
Referees.
Was it referees at that time? Okay. Who could do some of the work, and more of the work was delegated to them. Eventually they became semi-independent courts, and as you know, the battle had now been between the district judges who don't want to do any of the work, but don't want these bankruptcy judges to have any prestige, and the bankruptcy judges who want the prestige as long as they're doing the work. But that was a really idiosyncratic development.
Either way, aren't the bankruptcy judges more like staff attorneys? They make recommendations. They do the heavy lifting and they make recommendations. But am I right that they don't make the
most
final
of them?
Decision?
Most of them are final.
Are they final?
Yeah, I mean the district court still refers it to the bankruptcy court, but very rarely does a district court intervene. And there's a separate appellate route now. I mean, half the circuits have these BAPs that.
But I would bet, and Adam can tell me whether we both clerked at the Ninth Circuit. My experience, which is much less recent than Adam's, is that I would have, if I just had to guess, I would bet that in over 90% of the cases, the bench memo written by the staff attorney is the final decision that the judge reaches. I'll bet that, which is not to say judges don't independently think about it.
In immigration cases.
Well, I would have said even more generally. I would have, I think it was a rare case in which I wrote a bench memo and the judge came out differently.
Yeah, that's probably, I mean, the judges select clerks on a yearly basis, so there's an ongoing mechanism to ensure you have people's preferences map to your own.
But even the staff attorneys, the judges didn't choose.
I think that is probably right for immigration cases, maybe for long cases, I'm not sure about other cases.
I think your proposal is really interesting, and especially because this area of law is so broken, and also the comments on it. My concern, I guess, is what happens to precedent under it. Because if I understand your proposal, it's a specialized court with short-term appeals on a hot-button issue as serving as the court. Even if the assignments are sort of staggered, I can see a high potential for, as the judges change so often, major and views that they bring. So I was wondering if anything you could speculate about that.
Very thoughtful question. My thinking was that the Court of Appeals that I'm proposing would have the authority to set precedents, and my assumption was that it would set precedents in pretty much the same way that the regional courts of appeals set them today, which is once a decision is published and becomes precedent, every panel of that court is bound by those precedents, and therefore the only way to alter a precedent is for the court to go en banc, or in the case of the Ninth Circuit, a limited en banc. So my guess, my personal preference is that would continue to be the rule. I took the coward's way out in this proposal and decided to leave to the judges themselves the authority to issue the procedural rules that would govern that and a number of other procedural questions. I admit that's a wimpy way out of it, but it did seem to me that they would be best equipped to do that. The one issue that I really also have not come to grips with, I must admit, is how to do the transition. Right now, there are existing precedents in the various circuits, and I would have to figure out, do those disappear? Because there's no one circuit that ought to be binding on this new Court of Appeals for Immigration. Should it take a count on the number of circuits? How exactly should it do it? I don't have a convincing answer to that, but I think there are ways in which maybe the judges themselves could figure out the best way to handle it.
You couldn't have a 40-judge court. It's hard to imagine an en banc.
Right. It would have to be a limited en banc.
And you'd have some sort of a limited en banc. That court would become very important pretty quick, it seems to me, unless they were selected randomly as they're doing the Ninth Circuit.
I agree. I think the prospect of arguing before a 40-judge en banc court would be pretty scary.
That's the reason we have the 11th Circuit.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
tried to address it briefly in response to Jason's query. I don't know the answer. I don't. It's hard for me to predict whether the Supreme Court would be more likely to intervene. On the one hand, true, no opportunity for circuit conflicts. On the other hand, it's a specialist court, and maybe the Supreme Court would be more willing than it otherwise would be to review the decision when it knows it's handed down by specialists. But then again, they're not really specialists. They're also generalist judges. So I don't know how to predict that one.
Well, we know a little bit about what's happened with the Federal Circuit. In patent law, The Supreme Court left it alone for a long time, in part because there weren't circuit splits. But when enough of the justices decided the court had gone wrong on some issues, they've now heard a fair number of patent cases in the last decade. So I think there would be a tendency for them to intervene less because the main mechanism no longer exists. So it would be up to the justices to decide whether they were sufficiently unhappy with what the court was doing in a particular area for them to take the initiative, in effect, to act even without circuit splits. But the Federal Circuit case kind of argues both ways.
Can I add, I'm sorry, one more qualification to what both Larry and I just said? In the paper, I raised the question of whether, if Congress is dissatisfied with the centralization of so much power in one court, it might want to consider a modification, like either creating two or more smaller courts of appeals in different geographic locations, or making it the same court but in different venues. I think the main difference between those two modifications relates to the circuit conflict question. If it's one court that just sits in multiple places, then in a way it's kind of like a regional court of appeals. They sit in lots of different cities also, but that doesn't matter. They're still bound by the same precedents. If, in contrast, there are two or three different courts, then it might be like two or three different regional courts of appeals who are free to reach their own decisions, and then there would be the opportunity for circuit conflicts that the Supreme Court might then have a greater incentive to accommodate or to reconcile.
So I guess I have sort of just a thought maybe for Steve and a question for all of you guys about transition. The thought is, so I was trying to, I've never really thought much about the specialization question, but maybe the one way to kind of peel apart the different dimensions of the proposal runs it is, if we think about what makes the courts decide cases in certain ways, we've got kind of there's the selection dimension, which you've got to talk about, then there's the individual decision maker dimension. That's the priors of the judges, the incentives they have to come from oversight, things like that. And this funny kind of group dimension, which is the most important, right? And it seems like we know the least about the group dimension, maybe, so I have no sense of what specialization does there to the kind of cultural predisposition of judges who see themselves as socialized within this particular group. Whether the geographic proximity is actually important to that socialization, I have no idea. But it seems like probably the individual level, maybe this comes from clerking for a judge whose opinions are highly salient, is a question about whether when judges come to decide lots of immigration cases, whether that will make their profiles more publicly visible in a way that will affect their behavior, right? Because of the possibility of political backlash or supervision by higher, other judges, higher. And the selection dimension, one of the things I loved about your proposal is it seems like it has a couple of really nice things that allow you to peel apart and preserve some of the benefits of specialization without picking up some of the problems on the selection side of the field of specialization. So you first of all said, well, we're going to pick the judges out of this general pool. So you make sure that basically that when they're appointed by the president, they can't be appointed along one dimension, right? Because they're going to be general judges. So that seems great to me. It also seems to me like you had kind of advantage in the period one problem, the transition problem, because what I was always worried about Article 1 court is this idea that one president is going to appoint an entire court of like 40 to 50 people that's only going to decide these cases. Like, no one's going to think this is going to be a problem. But then Russell kind of gives me, okay, well, there's still a kind of transition problem here, because it still does give a lot of authority to one president to a lot of three judges, and obviously there's a very long history of lots of problems when there are fights around presidential transitions regarding the expansion of the judiciary. So I was just wondering, I guess this is just like a point of information, whether anyone has ever figured out successful strategies for this. Like, you sort of hinted at one, I thought, which is kind of
deferred implementation that builds a kind of uncertainty, right? So whether it's a rolled out implementation or an implementation that's deferred by a period of years to make sure you're in a presidential administration. But whether people have design ideas about other ways to do that, or whether in fact that's ever happened. So have we ever had a deferred implementation, say, an expansion of the future?
I don't have an answer, but I just want to say you're giving me credit for something that Russell came up with, which I hadn't thought of the idea of deferring.
He's just a
I can't think of any other than the bill that was knocking around, the omnibus bill was knocking around during the entire Bush administration, which said these judgeships aren't going to go into effect until they're not going to go into effect until a new president takes over, and at this point we don't know who the new president's going to be. I mean, it's kind of hard to see doing this thing on a staggered basis. The only other thing I was thinking is that the Court of International Trade is the only court, federal court, as far as I know, that specifies the party composition of its members. And no more than 6 members can be member of any one political party. And I've often wondered why that couldn't be attractive. I mean, I know why it'd be unattractive, but I don't know, that might be attractive in this scene. But that's still not stocking, that's not stocking the court. It's just, I don't know. Maybe you have a 20-judge court and you keep the BIA around for a while and it functions directly, and then you wait until there's a president of the next administration. But that's all very messy stuff that yeah. People think about all the time, but they're not going to stand up in the halls of Congress and say it, because it could acknowledge that there's a big difference in how judges make decisions. So not a big one, but there's a noticeable one. No, I think it'd just be all or nothing.
Also, one of the reasons I think that we're all having trouble coming up with any precedent is that it seems to me that it's this phenomenon of it being so hard to get a judge confirmed is really still fairly a modern phenomenon. I think it goes back roughly to the Newt Gingrich era in the 80s. Maybe I'm being unfair in thinking that's the point at which it started. But that's when I can remember the partisan politics becoming as extreme, starting to become as extreme as they are today. And maybe I'm slightly off on the timing, but I do remember that in the late 70s, Jimmy Carter, there was an omnibus bill passed by Congress that gave Jimmy Carter the chance to, he had a lot of federal judges, and I happened to clerk at the Ninth Circuit, I'm dating myself, from 1979 to 81, which is exactly when the composition of the court was utterly transformed, because Carter got to name a lot of judges. It went from being an overwhelmingly Nixon appointee court to an overwhelmingly Carter appointee court, and the relations among judges on the court were not pretty. I mean, there was tremendous polarization and fighting that went on, and I don't know if it's, I don't know, I'm hoping it's better today, but that's the last time I can remember a president having the power to really name a lot of judges, right?
The controversies over judicial appointments even today are on the Court of Appeals level. Most district judges sail through pretty easily. I mean, there's 2 Obama appointees now who are getting held up, but most of us, and so I think it'd be more, Larry may have a view of this, I think it'd be more a patronage matter than it would be an ideological matter. We're just not going to give the next president, I figured out, in a 40-judge court, we're not going to give the next president, depending on how you do it, 32 district judges and 8 court, we're just not going to do it. But it wouldn't be, I don't think you'd get in a lot of food fights. You may have a different view of that, but district judges sail through pretty easily, even still. But obviously, 12 Court of Appeals judges, that could change the composition of some of the courts of appeals, and that would create a real fight.
So much for coming today. This has been such a special day. Our participants came from all over the world, and I want to thank them and the commentators and all our journal editors who are helping make these pieces part of our May issue. And in terms of logistics, we're all going to put our name tags. There's a little basket at the door. We just have to return these to our events office. And then for everyone going to the airport now, we're going to meet with your drivers right outside this door, and we'll go down and get your bags from the journal office. But thank you again to everyone. This has been an amazing day, and I hope everyone's enjoyed it as much as I have. Thank you.